Welcome to Gardening for Beginners by Pauline Schneider. That's me. Several years ago, I created a little program for beginning gardeners, and I called it Preparing a Spring Garden in four parts: questions to ask yourself, location design, materials and methods, and resources. So why would you want to plant a garden? There are so many reasons right now. Besides economic, it's healthier, and it's a lot of fun. When you go back, you can pause these and really read these little slides and get a good idea of many reasons that we would grow our own personal garden. So, because of COVID-19, we have a food supply issue, and it's really important that each of us does our own part to start a small garden in any way that you can, in your backyard, in your living room, on your deck, on your patio, in a sunny window. If you just grow a couple little things, that will actually go a long way to helping you and your family or your partner maintain some sense of security and autonomy. Really important to grow the things that you like to eat. You don't want to grow a lot of stuff that you're going to end up throwing away. It's really important. One of the biggest mistakes beginning gardeners make is they want to grow everything. And they, you know, grow corn or broccoli or really, really difficult things that are heavy feeders and require a great deal of care and attention. So unless you're a happily retired individual with loads of money and the ability to hire someone to help you, I recommend against that. There's a lot of great food that you can grow. Tomatoes, squash, salad mixes, peas, mushrooms, rhubarb, strawberries, chives. I mean, herbs, by the way, are amazing. They just keep going and going. Herbs don't require a very fertile soil, so they're a really great way to start, and they're perennial, so for the most part, they will be there, you know, permanently, unless you have a very strange year or insects or some kind of weird disease. So where do you want to plant? You know, you have to really look at the location that you're in and analyze the soil, really check out your zones. There's, you know, obviously there are things that you're going to be planting that will be annual in some locations and perennial in others. And that's a really important thing to consider when you're purchasing seed or growing plants. Always check those seed packets. The information is all there. All the instructions that you need are on that seed packet for the most part. I mean, obviously, it's not going to tell you how much to water, how to pack it into the soil, but it will tell you how deep to plant that seed. And you really want to make sure that you know the different needs of your plants. Is it going to need a really shady spot or a really sunny spot, or does it tolerate both shade and sun? How much water does it need? You know, so these are all things that you're going to have to consider as you're planning and designing your garden. So, you know, make sure, because this is going to be a garden that you're going to have for a while. If you do plan ahead, it's a really great idea to really plan ahead. And, you know, if you invest a little bit ahead of time, then you can expand on your garden. So start small. Don't bite off more than you can chew. You know, we all get very ambitious. I am really guilty of that. But just really start small, because what happens is, you know, gardener burnout. All of a sudden you have this enormous garden to take care of, and you really want to go on that vacation. Now you have to hire somebody to come and watch it for you, or have a friend come over and water it. And, you know, and so all these things come into play. You're going to need tools. So don't forget, you know, you could buy all the tools in the shop, and that's still not going to do you any good. You want to be careful you know, where you're spending your money, and you don't want to have to buy too many tools. You just really want to get the basics. And that's really a trick. So don't go out and buy the most expensive tool, but also don't buy, you know, a really cheap thing. But you want a shovel. You want a good shovel. You want a good rake. You want a good hoe. And, you know, you don't have to buy all of these at once. You can start small, you know, a little bit at a time. When you first start planting your seeds, you are not going to need all of these tools. So it's a good idea to take your time and buy them as you need them. Don't go out and spend hundreds of dollars right away getting the most expensive, you know, top of the line. You really should not do that. I want you to conserve your energy, your money, your time. This is important. You know, I want this to be fun for you. I want this to be beneficial. So take your time and be very careful. Now, at some point, you may realize that you're going to need some fencing because you have critters. And it, depending on the kinds of critters you have, will determine the type of fencing that you need. If you have deer, you're going to need 6 to 8 foot fences that can keep a deer out. And that's really tricky. If you don't have deer, but there are other animals in the neighborhood, you know, maybe there are dogs or, you know, you've got badgers or woodchucks or whatever, you just probably need a normal sized 5 foot fence, maybe even just a 4 foot. But really critical is the fencing that goes underground. Seriously, you're going to need something to keep those burrowing varmints from getting under the fence and getting into your garden. That's probably the hardest thing. So, for instance, you know, you have voles or you have woodchucks, they're going to just tear up your garden no matter what you do, unless you put in some hardware cloth all around the edging of your fencing. So in addition to knowing what kind of fence you're going to need, that actually can help determine what kind of planting bed you're going to set up. And, you know, you want to make sure that you do the right thing for your area, for your region, for your climate, for your microclimate. And you want to plan it out very carefully because you're going to be putting in soaker hoses, sprinkler hoses. Maybe you're going to be hand watering. If it's a community garden, you will definitely be bringing water. So these are all things that you're going to think about. My personal preference is a raised bed or a hilled bed. It allows for proper drainage. Things don't get soggy and gross. It warms up faster, especially if you're in a colder climate in the springtime. You know, you want the roots to warm up faster. They're really nice. They're easy to protect from varmints. They're easy to weed. They're just nicer to work in. But, you know, that doesn't have to be the case. And there will be different situations. Maybe you will have a garden deck where you will have an absolutely raised bed that you don't even have to bend over or squat. And that will be really helpful. You know, that'll be a thing for people who have back issues or knee issues and can't squat and bend. You will probably want to build a bed that's above ground. And, you know, if you don't have those issues, you know, you can just plant right into the ground. Here's a picture of before when I started my garden in Katona. And it took me a great deal of work to rip that grass out and the weeds and everything and install the fencing and the beds and the hardware cloth all around the edge to keep the little rodents from crawling under the fence. It's not 100% proof ever. I looked out one day and there was a nice fat woodchuck. She was climbing right over the fence. She crawled up the side and went right into it. So there are drawbacks of a raised bed as well as the benefits. And it is a little more work, but really saves you a lot of work in the long run. So once you get your fencing planned and your planned out to, you know, you've got your bedding plan that you know what you're, how you're going to lay it out. You need to get ready to amend the soil. You could theoretically just start planting right into the ground that's there, but it's very likely that that soil has some issues, and it's really good to get a soil test. Not everybody does it, but it's a really good idea. You want to make sure there's no lead in the soil or any other contaminants that could be a problem. So, get a soil test, and definitely start to amend that soil. It's going to need compost. It's going to need lime. It's going to need some sort of rock dust. These are all things that are important for the microbial life, and those are the little creatures that make your plants grow and keep them healthy. So keeping your plants healthy is a combination of good best practices, companion planting, and keep making the environment healthy for a biodiverse flora and fauna. You want to remember the three B's of gardening: bees, butterflies, birds. If it's safe for them, it's safe for you. And you want those critters in your garden. They are a critical component of having a healthy and nutritious garden. For you and for them. This is how you want to do it. This is Doug DeCandia on the left, dear friend of mine. He grows food for the food bank in Westchester County, New York, and he is a hero in my book. So when you have problems like these little guys, you know there's probably an imbalance in the system. And there are ways of dealing with these guys that are natural and without having to spray tons of chemicals in your garden. There are practical and mechanical methods that you can employ to protect your plants. You can use floating row covers to keep them safe from these guys laying their eggs initially. And you can use neem away and other not very toxic types of pest controls to protect your plants and the birds, bees, and butterflies. Very important that every choice that you make makes them come first. There are different ways of watering. There are different methods, systems, and again, it's going to all depend on your setup and your availability. I mean, maybe you want to just go out there with a hand sprinkler and keep a close eye on your plants. But the thing is, you don't want to get those leaves wet. So if you always remember that, that will really prevent plant diseases. So obviously rain is the best water, but we have infrequent rains and we have too hard rains or we have not enough rain. And house water often is chlorinated. So one of the things that I do is I collect buckets of house water and I store it so that it has a chance for the chlorine to evaporate. Now, I briefly mentioned floating row covers. These are an amazing way to protect your plants, your crops, and also keeps your the flora and the fauna that you want to keep around safe. You want to hand weed, you want to mulch, you want to compost, all of that. So once you have all of these different components together, you're pretty much ready to start. Ideally, I always recommend, starting seedlings indoors in pots, in little starter pots, because that way you keep a good eye on them and they're starting off in soil that is clean, sterile, that doesn't have any viruses or bacteria or molds. And that's so important to give your plants a good launch. I'll cover some more of these things in more detail in another video, but for now, this is Pauline Schneider and I am signing out. Thank you for listening.